Hi, y'all.
Hi.
I had the opportunity to be the father of an awesome kid. Thank you all for coming out. Say I grew up Catholic, and if you sneezed or farted in church, you got backslapped. this is already one of the coolest memorials that I've ever been to.
Welcome, and thank you for coming together and sharing this space together. I think, I know, Tony is right here, so happy to see all of us and cruising around here with us right now, having the ultimate party. I was trying to think of how to start this off, and there's so many incredible people gathered here together. And in fact, I just wanted to tell you all right now, as I look out on all of you, I see Tony amplified by an infinite number through all of you. I know some of you and don't know others, but I see the whole of him right now that I never saw before, reflecting right back here at me in every one of you. So, and you're all so beautiful. Thank you. And
thank you.
Oh my goodness. So, you know, one thing, Tony, I think, inspired in all of us, every single one of us in a different way, to dig deep and to discover who we really are, what our passions really are, and then he held space for us to walk that path and do it together. And he honored that in every single one of you here, and for all of us it's very different. But I wanted to take a moment to share with you what I think the ultimate thing is that he did for me, and I hope that you can all take a moment to also bring into your brain that sense of self that he helped raise to another place. So for me, he saw my wolf and my raven, and he saw in me as he said I was an art shaman. And so, just a moment. With all of you here and the web and the tendrils extend so far beyond this space in Jackson. They actually extend way beyond the earth, as we all know. But I've been so touched to see everybody come together. And I really, I see this like beautiful golden white thread and web that he's woven around all of you, and it goes into your heart, and it comes out through your mind and your third eye, and then it goes into your heart and out through your third eye, and over there and over there, and it's everywhere. And we are all just so blessed to be connected by this web of love and passion and creativity and craziness and his ability to like throw himself physically and mentally into everything that he did, and we get to connect up with all of that now through all of you. And I should probably check my Tony pad because I can't remember if I was supposed to say. But I think that's probably it for now. You know, the shaman is about, there's many things it's about, but to try to simplify it, it's about helping facilitate journeys and healing and tapping into your imagination in a way that you never thought of before. And so tonight is it's a journey and it's an exploration and it's filled with love and passion. And thank you for letting me be a part of it and letting me share this with all of you. This love is incredible. I think my heart, well, I know it kind of, I know for all of us, our hearts exploded this week, but they also got really quickly refilled back up with love from each and every one of you and more, and from Tony. So thank you for that so much. And so now I'm going to hand this over to lovely Ren.
Amazing crowd. Sorry, I'm gonna cry. Everybody knows me. I'm really good at crying. I'm amazing at crying. I'll cry because I'm happy. I will cry because I'm sad. So I'm doing both right now, just so you know. Tony has told me 3 times to stop crying, but I'm gonna do my best. So the first thing I wanted to do was read a selection from the Tao that I'm pretty sure I was guided to this book this morning, and I kept opening pages. He's like, nope, nope, yes. So this is for you guys. I know this has been a really hard week for everybody. Tony is here. I don't think I need to tell most of you that, but he is here, and he is so stoked and so overwhelmed with this kind of love. And he wants this little reading to just give you guys some peace and to remind all of you where he is and that we're infinite and that he's all around. He's almost more present than he was before. We just don't get to give him our big squeezes, but he's here. So this is from him, from the Tao. In the beginning was the Tao. All things issue from it. All things return to it. To find the origin, trace back the manifestation. When you recognize the children and find the mother, you will be free of sorrow. If you close your mind in judgments and traffic with desires, your heart will be troubled. If you keep your mind from judging and aren't led by the senses, your heart will find peace. Seeing into darkness is clarity. Knowing how to yield is strength. Use your own light and return to the source of the light. This is called practicing eternity. So that's from him. First of all, a little moment of levity. We're gonna have a lot of those. Does everybody know about this shirt? Some people? It's my favorite shirt of Tony's. We all have our favorites. This is mine. I think it's probably some others too. So he's had this for a long time. Of course, he made it, and it's got stains and all kinds of things on it. And then he wrote, you're disgusted because you're judging. Awesome. So I just want to share one little story. When I first met Tony, I was going through one of those life situations where I knew I needed to make some really big, brave decisions that were going to be really uncomfortable and were going to hurt someone I really loved. But it was really, I needed to do it. And Tony was just so by my side during this whole thing, just being his non-judgmental, just loving person, just making me laugh and keeping me strong and not giving me anything, any kind of big advice, just being there for me. And it was the first, he went to Burning Man with us that year, and I don't know if anybody has that video that he took. I think I have it somewhere, but if somebody has it, we need it. But anyway, so he went to Burning Man with us, and he did a little video, and he got me out of my tent one early morning, covered in playa dust with my little furs on, and he was like, Ren, I want to interview you. And I was like, oh, God. He's like, no, it's going to be cool. We need to do this. It's cool. Dust yourself off a little bit, which is impossible there. A lot of us know that. And just, I'm going to interview you. So we did. And then I went back to reality camp and was dealing with my heavy time. And he came over one day and he had the video and he was like, okay, let's watch this. And I'd never seen myself on video before. And I did not want to see it. And so I sat down and my part came up and I watched it and I was transfixed. Because what he allowed me to do was to see me through his eyes. And he loved every single person in this room and he helped us all see our own beauty. And I watched that and I was like, I like her. I like her. I would hang out with her. I would.
I like her too.
You know? And I'm super protective of my friends. And that was the day I became my friend. I'm not even kidding. Thank you, Tony. And right after that, I made a very hard decision, and I made it with grace and dignity and love. And I love you, Tony, and I love all of you guys. And thank you for being here. It means the world to all of us and to him. So thank you. Casey, we need you. Come on down.
You can do it.
I barely slept in a week. That symbol behind me is the infinite love symbol. Came into my life many, many years ago. And one day I wound up at somehow working for TGR and I walked out onto the deck barefoot and out comes the other door, another dude barefoot. And I instantly recognized my brother. And the infinite love that he carried around with him and just reflected right back at me. And we struck up many, many, many conversations. All you have to do is keep talking, joining together in community. I call this meeting to order at 4:19, not because I want to smoke pot at 4:20, but because Matthew says at 4:19, I will make you fishers of men. And if you look around this audience, you know Tony was a fisher of men and women. especially the women, you Burke Holes babes. Y'all need to start a Facebook page. Because he said to me once upon a time, I wish they'd just all get along because they're so fucking beautiful and so awesome. And I love every one of them. And I wish they'd just learn from each other and stop trying to own me or them. And just love one another. And damn, you girls are so beautiful. Woo! So beautiful. And we had a burning desire, he and I. How could we create a cooperative stewardship of Mother Earth and all her relations? How could we create that? How could we replace dominion in the Bible with the word stewardship so that the rest of the world would get the concept that this is our home and we should take care of it and each other? And I helped him along that path, and he helped me. And you're all gathered in this room today, and you are so fucking creative. You know, whether you're slashing some fucking pow, or making videos, or loving each other, or even partying, you guys are having a good time and being creative. And I woke the other morning from a dream of Tony, Thursday morning, and the words echoed in my mind, I awake. In the presence, in the endeavor of the eternal now. I am another being creative. I am. And we are all now another being creative. We're all others, and we're all us's. And as soon as we can let go of that separation, that idea of division amongst ourselves, you know, replace love with any concept that somehow we're separate from each other, because we have one fucking planet. One Yoneh verse. One verse. One cosmic hum. One infinite love. One chance at this life of making it the best we can. And Tony, man, he got up every fucking day and he suffered with how the fuck do we make us all come together? How do we do this? How can we put the effort forth? And in that light, he often neglected himself. Often forgot to take care of himself. And Monday evening, he forgot to take care of himself. And that's why we're here, so we can take care of each other in this.
Love Casey.
Love Casey. What
happened? I love Tony. Fucking buffalo dancing Burke Holes. More than I've ever loved a brother, especially in this fucking Teton range. I have to salute my brother Cody and Noah. This lives in their house in Placidas, New Mexico. And we went all snowboarding last week together and had a fucking raging time. And Monday at 5:30, we're like, all right, we're done with business. Let's go to the wart. So we went to the wart and had a few drinks. And everybody's like, he wanted some pinky cheese. And I'm like, no more cheese and bread. And please, no more cheese and bread. You ever been to the Amigani? He's like, no, neither have I. I'm like, fuck, let's go. I'm splurging. And we went and we threw down. We threw down. We had, we sampled everything we loved and everything we wanted. And his last supper was a beautiful one. We were joined by great friends and we had great conversations. And one of the conversations, again, was how do we bring everybody together? What a fucking crazy way to answer that question. But I'm so glad he has. And I'm so glad he's brought us all together in this room. Let's find a way to get through it. Whatever differences we might have, dude, man, bro, bra, in this town, and find a way to create together, to save the fucking buffalo, to save the wolves, to save the grizzlies, to save the fucking earth that we have as our home. I'm sorry I'm coasting so much for you all back at home, but you know what? I loved him so fucking much, you know, and that adjective is just, what the fuck, man? You lucky bastard to escape this mortal coil and the time of turmoil it is and to bring us all together in this message of hope and peace and infinite love. I love you all. Thank you.
Hi, you guys. Oh no, I actually have to read from it. I'm here representing today. I'm sure you're wondering why I'm up here. I'm kind of wondering that too, because what a great honor. Wow. I'm here representing Danielle. She's watching right now. She's in, somewhere.
We love you, Danielle!
She sent this to me, and she asked me to read this for her, and it's a great honor. And it's crazy because I look around at you guys, and I have never seen a more diverse and amazingly fleshed out loving crowd. I see every face in Jackson that I love to see. It's bananas. I think that we all have that great love that just sticks in our craw. And I reckon that Tony's stuck in her craw, and I certainly know she's stuck in his. So this is from Danielle, and I'm gonna try to do it justice. It's quite beautiful, and I apologize for reading from my phone. I kinda wanna put on the Raven mask. Staring at the shapes we had discovered in your wooden ceiling, when you told me about the performers in your mind, the men in spandex suits putting on spectacular show just for you. They had stopped and you followed them out to the parking lot where they loaded up the van. You pleaded with your eyes that they continue the show. They surrendered to your request, of course they would, reluctantly putting out their cigarettes and began the performance again, as you grinned from ear to ear mischievously. Years later, we would laugh and argue as to whose experience this memory belonged to. You can have it. I owe it to you. You brighten my world. We laughed so hard, loved even harder, and you let me be me. I tried so hard to let you be you. Sorry, I can't see. Ultimately, that's what I love the most about you, your willingness to conform, your unwillingness to conform to me or anyone else. You would never belong to me. You belong to the earth, and now you belong to the stars. I will look for you, listen for you, and forever hear your voice echo. Follow your heart, Dee. I'm just going to add one small thing because I thought a lot about this, and the overwhelming arch of what I see in this crowd is all of your guys's, your addiction to wonder, your willingness to be dazzled, all of you, that's the one thing you guys have in common. And I mean, aside from loving Tony, which obviously is the truth. So I'm just gonna read a couple of words from Mary Oliver because it resonated with me, and I reckon it'll resonate with you. Still, what I want in my life is to be willing to be dazzled, to cast aside the weight of facts, and maybe even to float a little above this difficult world. I wanna believe I am looking into the white fire of a great mystery. I want to believe that the imperfections are nothing, that the light is everything. Thank you. Thank you, Tony.
Honored that I get to be up here, because so many of you, like everyone has said, so many of you were so important in Tony's life, and I mean, I don't even need to know you to know that, and that's been reiterated many times, so it's probably redundant for me to say, but I just feel that I have to say that I'm just grateful. I'm just so grateful that I was lucky enough to call Tony a dear friend. And I'm just grateful that he's always given me permission to sing and to pursue being me. And if all of you follow him on SoundCloud, I'm sure you do, you really need to listen to the interview that he liked that on Bill Murray, on what it is to be Bill Murray. You should listen to it, because it really epitomizes everything Tony didn't need to preach about, but indirectly spoke to all of us about through his actions and through his love in our lives. So right now I want to dedicate a song to you, Tony, because you always gave me permission to be me and to allow me to sing.
Go, girl!
Yeah.
I struggled all week knowing this moment was going to come, and I tried to write some things down, and every time I did, I started bawling and losing my composure, and I kind of like to keep myself together. Tony gave me shit about that. I'm going to make a long story short, if I can. When Tony was conceived, I was 19 years old. I never wanted any children, was very adamant that I was not going to have children. His mother was told that her chances of getting pregnant were very slim. And so when she called me on Christmas Eve and gave me the news, I was a little distraught. But anyways, the day that baby boy was born, I bawled like a baby. I could tell instantly he was mine. And I guess I wept even more on the day of his death. It's so tragic, the song Cats in the Cradle and the Silver Spoon, that was us, because I was taught as a young man to bust your ass and have all your material things, and that's the way that life worked. And so that's what I was busy doing, and Tony would have to go to the junkyards with me because I was fixing cars and played by himself out in a oil pit and stuff like that. But anyways, this is a little hot for me. I'm not a shaman, I'm an asshole. How'd that feel? Yeah, so anyways, we had a fantastic life together. My son taught me more about life than anyone in this world. And if I would have listened to him more than I did, I'd be a better person today. He tried to teach me more than I would absorb. A lot of times when he was saying the things he was to me, one in particular was, I picked him up out in Joshua Tree. He'd been living out in a desert. So, I got him to take a shower and change his clothes and what he thought comb his hair. I was kind of got on him. I'm like, dude, I said, don't you want something? Aren't you materialistic? Can't I get you this through your head that we all need a fancy car and a nice house and that's the way it is? He's like, Dad, you're the one missing it. He said, you ever been out here and done this? He said, you'll find your soul out here. And he made me think about it. He was so incredibly happy without a penny to his name. Living in a kind of a little commune thing that all he had to do was a couple chores every day to kind of pay his room and board, and his spirit, I could feel him. I got it then, that he knew more about life than I did. And it's a great honor to know that I had something to do with his life, that I exceeded all of my expectations of him because of him, and he exceeded all of mine. Just that this whole room was full of love for the guy that really didn't have a bad thing to say about anybody. If he did, he did it respectfully.
With sarcasm.
Most of the time. But, you know, I hear these stories, and I'm going to hear a bunch more tonight, I hope, about how Tony impacted you and the things that he did in this world to impact the world. That not a lot of us can say that we've done what he's done. And, it's continuing. That's my next request. So from this day forward, I don't want any pity. I don't want people to come up to me and say they're sorry. And they're sorry for my loss and their loss and all that stuff. I've had it up to here. I want you to say, you know what? Your kid inspired me to be a better person. I held the door today for somebody I would have never held the door for before. Yes. I've really been struggling. Tony and I had a really awesome psychic connection that we almost always knew when the other one was going to call or when the other one wanted the other one to call. We thought a lot alike. We are a lot of like in different mannerisms in his life that may not have been the good ones in most women's eyes. But when I walked into this room tonight, and I got to back up a little bit. So I didn't believe it when I got the phone call. I'm like, no, he's not gone. I would have known. He would have sent me a message. I would have felt it. And I didn't feel anything. There was nothing there. And that's why I couldn't believe it. And when I walked into that room and saw him there, the first thing I wanted to do was rip all that shit right out of the wall and put my son to rest. I probably wouldn't have came if I'd have known the condition that he was in. And now that I did, I'm so happy that I did. It's been a tough road, but you know what? Like Tony would say, strap on some balls and fucking deal with this. And so we made that pact, by the way, too. We talked about life and death, and I just assumed that I was preparing him for mine, but he told me his wishes. And we both agreed to come back from the spirit world and kick each other's ass if there's any of this bullshit. So. But anyways, when I walked in and saw this, I felt his spirit. I touched everything on this table, and that's my boy.
Yeah.
Yeah. First thing I wanted to do was beat this drum, yeah. But I thought it was kind of inappropriate. I couldn't be prouder, I really couldn't. going through Tony's things and trying to sort them out and pick out things that were his and special to him and that kind of thing. And he, little shit, never signed anything.
He never signed anything.
Yeah, he did an amazing pencil drawing of one of my sculptures one time, and he gives it to me in a frame, and I'm like, you gotta sign this. He goes, well, dude, it's already in the frame. I go, no, bullshit. And so I made him pull it out of the frame and sign it. And I think on the back it says, my dad's still an asshole. So, anyways, Tony had the gift. Tony's mother and I, she's an amazing woman. And from the time that we separated, Tony was very young, until about a week ago, I swore I would never forgive that woman. And Tony had a problem. He's like, you both need to get over this. And I was like, I'm okay with it. I'm not holding resentment, but I'm not gonna go give her a hug, you know? And because of this experience, we love each other, we've embraced each other, and we've forgiven each other. Tony had the blessing to have a bonus mom. And she was my wife. We were together for, I believe, 23 years. And we're still friends on Facebook. Anyways, I was so overcome with this that I forgot to call her. And it didn't dawn on me until hours later. And actually a good friend of mine was like, did you call Jenny? And I couldn't even call her. I was a frickin' mess. And so I did get a hold of her, and she took the news as like a mother would. She was an amazing woman. She loved Tony like her own son. They baked together. They, she even got the opportunity to crack him on the side of the head a couple of times because he was being a dumbass. But I couldn't ask for a better woman than she was a mother to him. And I'm sorry that we're not together anymore, but that's what life deals you sometimes. But she did write this, and I think it's pretty cool. Some universe somewhere got a bonus today when Tony left us to go to them. He was meant to spread his awesomeness. He did that here and will continue to, period. I'm dyslexic as hell, so bear with me. You did well raising him. That's why he has to leave us. Others need his wisdom and hugs too. Thanks, Jenny. Well, with that being said, I'm going to quote Tony the best I can. I went to the opening of the Sammy C Project in Portland. It's been 2 years ago now, maybe something like a year and a half, whatever. And they pushed him out on stage. I literally pushed him. And he got out there and did an amazing job thanking everybody in the project. And he said, with that being said, follow your dreams, follow your heart, follow your passion, be nice to others. I cried. I was so fucking proud that that was my boy. And he had an audience, huge. And they all got to hear that. And I hope they got something out of it. Because if we said that to each other every day, this world would be different.
Years old, and if anybody wants me to tell him about it, I'll tell him. Paul, he loved you, man. He was so proud of the art you did and everything. And I'm just, this is really nice. Thank you for the chance.
Amazing. Again, my heart is so full right now, and I've been asked, and thank you so much for this incredible honor, to share some words from Tony's mom, Teresa. Teresa and Kehlani had to go back to Minnesota, and that's Kehlani's sister, and so was asked to share these. And when I'm finished, I think we can then go into the slideshow after. Kind of hot.
Yeah. Take it off!
I might just have to put the mask back on.
Go for it!
Tony's special family of friends. We wish we could be with you tonight, but sometimes life decides otherwise. Thank you kindly for your thoughts and prayers through this journey. The stories shared of the silly, crazy, or gracious moments with Tony have eased our heartache. Sorry, my eyes. Few have said Tony was the unofficial mayor of Teton Valley in Jackson. But his reign touched many near and far. Along with his artistic passions, he was the keeper of hearts, tending to us when we needed comfort, rejoicing in our accomplishments, encouraging us to pursue our dreams, and loving us all no matter what. Tony was an old, authentic soul, visualizing life through a hopeful child's eyes, challenging nature's limits like an immortal teenager, offering wisdom beyond his years. On his keychain is a ribbon that carries the message, "Be kind, love everybody." A simple request, but not so easy to do, Please honor his memory by trying. Never doubt. Tony loved each of you immeasurably and knew that you loved him. We will all miss him beyond words. With love and endless hugs, Teresa, Bob, and Kehlani. Letting me be a part of it, and all of you for joining us all on this journey together, and Sasha for that incredible compilation. I know Tony gave many of us the gift of video and photos that he did for all of us in so many different ways. I have some memories of a special time in Jackson with all of us, with Tony at the core of it, that I never would have had if he hadn't have preserve that for me, and thank you all for pulling this together. This is incredible. My heart is so full. As we wrap up this element of our gathering, which I hope will obviously continue and spill on in whatever fashion it needs to afterwards, you know, we all know Tony's connection with the buffalo, and buffalo is certainly one of his spirit animals. And, you know, the buffalo represents, it's the place of the north, and the north is the place of the shaman's death. And the shaman's death leads to rebirth, and it's all about renewal and letting go and then coming back up in the east in the spring with the eagle. And buffalo is an incredibly powerful totem for somebody like Tony. His other one, we all have many animal totems and things that influence us, but one of the other influences of his was his earth totem, which is a woodpecker. Yeah, I bet none of you knew that. A woodpecker for Tony. Actually, that's kind of funny. Okay, so the woodpecker represents something really big and important. This was not in my Tony notebook.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Hey, but really, the sound of with the tree.
Yeah,
is,
great.
I'm so flustered.
Phrasing.
Native Americans and all of us believe that it's emulating the heartbeat of the earth. And when the drums are played, I mean, there's a lot of many different reasons why drums are played, but one thing it does is it connects us all with the heartbeat of the earth. And Tony's animal totem was about the drums and connecting us to the heartbeat of the earth. How beautiful and perfect is that, in perfect balance with the buffalo, and, you know, the timing of his birth as well. It was the end of June, right after the solstice,
And it's pretty much opposite of where we are right now. And Tony was all about yin and yang. I mean, wasn't he? I mean, somebody, you know, so the woodpecker is the opposite of the buffalo. And someone, God, everybody said so many beautiful things on Facebook. Thank you for that. I've never loved Facebook as much as I have for this opportunity for all of you to share with all of us. But I think it was Chip who described Tony, I won't say it as beautifully, but he met him first out in the desert in Burning Man, and that he was like, it's like he was on fire and a calm pool of water all at the same time. You know, and such a beautiful yin and yang about him, the masculine, the feminine, all this stuff that came together. He really embodies it all, present tense. Tony is with us and continuing to shine through all of us forever and so much bigger. I know, I feel like I could talk forever about how amazing he is. Says we all, no. Everybody needs to shift gears. But I will put the mask on for our drum circle. I think that it would be a really lovely, fitting way to wrap this up if we'll play some drums over here for a few moments. And I would love for everybody to, you know, I've had the pleasure, the immense pleasure of looking at all of you tonight, and through these lights I've really tried to see, I see every single one of you in your hearts and your minds, and so, but you all haven't really had a chance to look around to each other and connect in with this incredible room in the same way that I have, so I think I'd like us to wrap this up by, we'll start playing some drums, and I think everybody should, not this very second, because it'll get very loud, stand and turn and look and hug, heart hugs. If you shift gears and you go this way, instead of the normal way, it's your heart to heart hugs. That's a big thing that Tony loved. And hold hands and do what we ever need to do, but you know, that thread that I see weaving through all of you, it would be amazing if we could all just create that together. And we'll just have a few moments of reflection, and then we can just peel away.
Do we have a time limit? So, Lindsay, you're awesome. Said, I'm not worthy to receive you, is what I told you. So, let's listen to the drum for a little bit, and then I'd like to either pass the mic, or, you know, I think that might be better than people might be a little more likely to talk if they're not standing up on stage. And so there's this really cute little girl over here. I'm not sure. Oh, there's two of them. Go figure. I want to really thank you all for coming and for this, I don't know how you're doing this, posting this on Facecrack thing or whatever's going on, but that's really cool because the people back home and the people that can't be here can be a part of this and they can send their message of love and so
There you go, girls.
I only met Tony in October of this year. I moved here from New York, and the weekend that we got together, I was completely lost. My friends were gone, the only two friends that I made here, and I was alone in this new house with this new job opportunity, and I already suffered from being in dark places, and I didn't know where to go or who to go to because I was alone here. And then I get a message from a guy saying, "Hey, I'm at Westside if you're around." And I say, "Who's this?" And he says, "Just some creepy guy you gave your number to." And I say, "Don't say that. Who are you, really?" And he said, "It's Tony." And I said, "Oh my God, yes, Tony. I'll be there in 20 minutes. And from that day on, we were inseparable. He showed me Teton Valley. He is my Teton Valley. He is in my heart forever. He made me see somebody who was unable to see, because even tonight people are saying that I'm shining more beautiful than ever because he told me to stop hiding behind my demons and to shine bright, because I am special and I do have a purpose in this world, even if I don't think it every day. But he showed me that I do, and I'm forever internally grateful. And I love you, Tony.
To bury his son. My name's Mike, and I have the honor of protecting the buffalo up in Yellowstone. And Tony and Jules, the guy back here, came up the first time I ever had the honor of meeting him, with a wild, wild Native American man. Named Blue Thunder. In our relationship, I refer to myself as a Vidiot as well. So Tony and I had that bond in common. But I'm a bit of a dinosaur in that age. I started out long before Tony was born, and he currently is working on he's currently was working on our whole life work at the Buffalo Field campaign, and has all our video, and that's how much he was entrusted to us as a brother. And you know, I don't know a lot of you people in this room, you know, and I'm sad that I didn't get to meet half of Tony's family, but we came down tonight and we got to drive home tonight to go be back with those buffalo because they need our help. But Tony, like you said, walked through many worlds. He talked to everybody. There was no prejudice bone in his body, and he wanted to unite the people. And I think when we look at today's world and what we're all up against, you know, I'm sure the vast majority of you weren't very happy that Trump has taken over our kingship in this nation. But to be honest with all of you, this is what we need. This is what America's become, a reality TV show. And we are the people that are willing to do something, to make a change. It doesn't have to be art, doesn't have to be anything. It's us coming together as a family of all nations to stand up and make a difference, because we are the only hope the world has. If we're gonna sit around and wait for these congressmen and senators and presidents to make the change of what's right for all walks of life, all beings on this planet, we have to come together and be that change we want to see. And Tony always said that. Tony will never, ever, ever leave our hearts. But let's fulfill the mission that Tony wants us to be on. Is find your passion in life. Find what you think's wrong. And stand up and do something about it. Because if you don't do it, nobody will. And I openly invite all of you to be part of our Buffalo family and to come up and stand with us with the Buffalo, because that was something very important to Tony in his life, and it should be important to all of you, because together we will create this change, because that is our destiny. Sir, I can't tell you how honored I am to meet you. And I hope that someday I can take you up and show you those buffalo that meant so much to Tony. That's all. Tony lives on, and so do we.
We sang Amazing Grace at the time that Tony left us. And luckily for us, this little lady right here knew all the words. And she also sang a song from her heart that crushed us all. So we need to take our hat off to you. And thank you.
Every time I think of him, I
last time I was on the bike, the last time I was ever seen was Tony riding his bike at the Coliseum. Oh my God, did we heckle Tony? Every time Tony dropped in, you just held your breath. It's just like, okay, Tony's dropping in, and there was a big calm. And then Tony was in the roof, and Tony was on the walls, and Tony was everywhere. He was just flying all over the place, blasting and crashing and people cringing. Just scared out of our minds when Tony would just get up. And we'd be like, oh my God, how the hell did he get up? Did you hear that noise? Did you see the look on his face when he hit the ground? And then he was just up again. Tony was pretty Tony. Tony was gay Tony. Tony was fat Tony. I don't know how they call him with fat Tony, but he was calling fat Tony. No matter what Tony was, it was Tony. The Berserker. Berserkle. Going for it. Going for it. When he was going for it in life, when he was going for it on his bike, he's going for it everywhere.
Yeah.
Brothers in arms, I want to see him. Bring them up. Bring them up. So we built this skate park. Billy Weiss over here probably talked to him that same day too. But they were probably both working, doing some other shit that, you know, we had built the park and it was done. There it was. And I was sitting at the counter just like, man, what the fuck did we do here? Who's gonna pay for this shit? Huh? Am I gonna lose my house? And Tony walks in the door and he's just like, hey, I'm Tony. Shakes my hand and I'm like, okay, what do you do? He's like, oh, I ride bikes. I was like, cool. Dude, let's go have a session. And it was like, instantaneous. We're having a session. And then I said to everybody, like, dude, there's this cool cat. He just moved to town. His name's Tony. We should all have a session. And then that night, we had another session. And right away, out of the gate, oh my God, I was scared. Here's Tony, like, right out of the gate, just going for it, freaking making everybody scared out of their mind.
Yeah, so scared.
And then, like, within the same breath, he's like, yeah, I'm around. Do you need any help? I was like, sure. Okay, and then probably within the same week, it's like 3 o'clock in the morning, and we're still at the skate park. We just had a big session and we're bruised and bloody. And, you know, I said, we gotta rebuild this shit. This isn't right. So, you know, out come the saws and the hammers, and it was one of the sessions. Tearing shit apart in the middle of the night. You know, I know there's a bunch of other dudes here that we all did the same thing, and Tony just like jumped right in there. No hesitation. Wanted to make it happen no matter what it was. If I had said, hey, let's tear the whole building down tonight and put it back up for tomorrow and paint it freaking purple, Tony would have done it. And he would have had it just perfect over and over again. So I don't know how else to describe it except just enthusiastic, like over enthusiastic. Like anything goes. No matter what we said, he would just make it happen. So if anybody else wants to follow us up, come on up.
Yeah!
I met Tony when I was about 12 years old. I was just a small little man. I had no security, no self-confidence, not a bite of courage inside my body. I met him at the Coliseum, as Bieber was just talking about. And I've seen him take the gnarliest goddamn slams I've ever seen in my entire fucking life. He's right back up like a fucking boss. The boss he is. Was. Is. No, fuck that. He is. The goddamn champion. And we will always suffer now and live the rest of our lives as the champion that he lived. I have to dedicate the entire, I mean, every major life decision that I make that ultimately winds down to who I really am inside, tumbles all the way back down to people like Tony, and Tony in particular. I love that motherfucker like it. I mean, it's ridiculous. I love that man, and I'll miss him for the rest of my life.
Ornamental.
for years with the audience, people that are here tonight, and of course, Tony's love for bikes brought him to the shop and had him hanging around, and all the faces, Tim and Fitzy, and they all were so passionate about it, but you know, we would talk to Jen all the time about it, just he wanted to find a girlfriend, that was his main goal at the time. What I gather the most from everything that everyone said on Facebook, there's a familiar tune to everyone's story, and it's deep conversations, so much love, so much creativity, so much believing that life is so much bigger and that there's something more to it. He loved God, he loved everyone, he loved everything, and just a creative, creative being. He loved animals, people, he embraced everyone, he crossed over every line. He loved people from religious groups, he loved people from, you know, any kind of picky group, he loved, he had no lines, he had lines.
Tell somebody you're here.
like, I love you. You're the only one that gets to know for like months. And so I told him, and he was super excited, and he was just like, it was incredible. And it was an awesome moment just to share that with him, and his reaction was great. But then what happened, the coincidence